About 6:30 this morning, while I was still asleep, half hour before my alarm went off, my phone started going off, vibrating and making noise, and I thought it might be important because there were like 6 or 7 texts right in a row, and I opened it up and found out Pastor Darlene was sick, and she was asking for help. So I returned the text and then laid back down and shot right back into bed, realizing I hadn't volunteered to do the sermon. This is what it is. Well, actually, first, I need to answer the burning question that's on everyone's mind. The thing that I've been asked most often today and over the last 4 days, what happened to my mustache? Well, this month is Men's Health Month, also known as Movember. And what that's about, you'll have to excuse me here. I had to go analog. That's how prepared I am this morning. No electronics. Movember is a month where we talk about men's issues in health. The truth is that most of us men think we're tougher, better than, don't need to see a doctor. We can power through it, no big deal. Most of us men won't admit we have problems, won't admit to depression. Most of us men don't want to go see the doctor, don't want to get a checkup. So I have a few statistics here. Prostate cancer. It's the number 2 most prevalent cancer in the U.S. right now. 161,360 new cases will be this year alone. 26,730 of those cases will end in death. That is from a cancer that has a 98% survivability beyond 5 years. 98% survivability. If caught early. But 26,000 will die. The most common cancer among young men 15 to 34 is testicular cancer. It's 100% survival if caught. 100%. And hundreds are going to die from it. That's shocking to me. So what Movember is about is everybody gets together, groups of men get together, and we try to figure out ways to promote those statistics, to help men understand that their health is important, mental and physical. So here in this church and around the community, we have groups, mine, headed by Sean Clays, is the charming, simply charming Moe's. And our group is attempting to raise money and awareness. And the way we do that is we lose the mustache, and then for a month we don't shave. And anytime anybody asks us about it, we give them those statistics and tell them the most important thing. Tell your brothers, tell your cousins, tell your significant other. Tell your father, have that uncomfortable conversation and talk about prostate exam. Talk about testicular cancer. Talk about it. It's not comfortable. It's embarrassing. It's embarrassing for us more than it is for you. If you're women, y'all are kind of used to it. Turns out that a lot of men have a lot to say about women's health. But women don't generally get a say in ours, so I'm encouraging you to speak out, because I know you love us and you want us around, so make the effort. Be embarrassed. Also, in the spirit of that, there is a concert put on by Concerts for a Cause, which is Sean Clays and crew. They're going to be benefiting that on November 25th. And if you have the time, Come on out. And that's enough on that. So, Luke 21:1. As Jesus looked up, he saw the rich putting their gifts into the temple treasury. He also saw a poor widow lady put in two very small copper coins. Well, let's start with the copper coins. They're exactly what they would be today, right? They're the smallest denomination of coin that you can possibly come up with. Even then, just 2 pence, 2 cents. Second, let's talk about this poor widow. A lot of times we think of the widow as being elderly, maybe crippled, coming is on an old cane up to the front of the church and putting in her last 2 coins. That's the story we all know, right? Except the average lifespan of a woman in the first century was from 22 to 28. 22 to 28 years old. That's how old this widow would have been. Do we have anybody here that is in that age range? Stand up if you're in the age range. Nobody? How about a little older? Yep, there you go. I have a picture. Can you move the slide? I think it's too old. That one right there. There's an accurate picture. She's young. And she has no money. So the next thing here is this median. Truly I tell you, he said, this poor widow has put more in than all the others. All these people gave their gifts out of wealth, but she gave hers out of poverty, put in all she had to live on. Now we usually think about that as Jesus telling us to support the church rather than human need. And honestly, during a time of stewardship and we're trying to get money, that is a great message. But it really, there's more to it. If we look one chapter before, right at the end of the chapter, not spread out across a bunch of verses, but right at the end of the chapter, just before this, it reads, "Then in the hearing of all the people, he said to his disciples, 'Beware of the scribes, who desire to go around in long robes, love greetings in the marketplace, the best seats in the synagogues, and the best places at feasts, who devour the widow's houses, and for the pretense make long prayers. These will receive greater condemnation.'" Devour the widow's houses. Doesn't that change things for you? Instead of a widow taking her last 2 coins and quietly coming up to the priest and dropping her last 2 cents in, Luke 20:45 begins to give us a clearer picture. The picture of a woman who has lost everything, whose house and wealth, whose livelihood was devoured by the church at the time. Devoured. Not eaten, not taken, but consumed. Used up, greedy, repossessed. This is a woman who has no home to go back to. No children to depend on. This is a woman who has lost everything but these 2 pennies. What they call a mite. I can't imagine her coming humbly to the church. In instead, I see a woman walking up to the church and saying, "You took everything. You took it all. You might as well have that too." I know, that's not what we've heard before. I understand. But there's another verse, one that has helped enlighten me on this passage. It's Mark 7:27. "First, let the children eat all they want," he told her, "for it is not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs." Of course, that's not the only one. I also like 1 Timothy 5:8, which I don't have on the slide. "But if anyone does not provide for his relatives, and especially for the members of his household, he has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever." Or how about 1 Corinthians 3:17? "Anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him, for God's temple is holy, and you are that temple." What about 3:16? "Do you not know that you are God's temple, and that God's Spirit dwells in you?" Told you I would handle on this. Why would Jesus tell this story? And why is it misunderstood? To start with, I think Christ, in saying what he said, let me pull that back around here. "Truly I tell you," he said, "this poor widow has put more in than all the others. All these people gave their gifts out of wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put in all she had to live on." I don't think he's praising her. I think he's crying. I think this is a lament. He looks and sees a widow that has nothing and sees her give up. Give up life. And I think he cries. But what's the point of the story? It's hard for us to think of the man that willingly died on the cross as a revolutionary. But he was. Jesus began the revolution and said, "Never again. Never again. Never again will the marginalized be left out of the blessings of God and the church call it good. Never again will we turn a blind eye where our leaders harm those in poverty and the church call it good. Never again will people who don't fit the mold be left on the threshing floor and the church call it good. Never again. Never again. Never again. Unless we let it." Jesus calls us to remember that widow and to put our all in the basket. To be all in. To be the voice of protest and solidarity. That stands with the least and the lost. To be all in substantive gifts of charity and substantive efforts toward justice. To be all in to education of our young people and the iron sharpening iron experiences for our adults. To be all in our connections and gifts to make justice happen, not just lament how things are. This is a call to activism. This is a call to stand up. Not to passively put money in the plate and call it good enough. This is a call to cry for the widow. This is a call to make sure that never again. I'm getting around to it. Now, what does that mean for us? I'm not going to lie. This church is hurting for money. And this sucks. funny way for me to ask for money, right? Strange that I would tell you not to give your last dime. You've all heard that $5,000 number. We are $5,000 short every month. We gotta make it up. Do you know what the most common response to that is? Gosh, I wish I could win the lotto. Then I could just pay for it. I could get $5,000 a month easy if I could win the lotto. I don't want your lotto money. We don't want your lotto money. This is a good thing. Don't get me wrong. That offer to win the lotto and pay it for us, that means you feel responsible for the things, the missions of this church. And we have some fantastic missions. Jody just talked about the angel tree. Never again will a child in this community go without Christmas. Turkeys tackling hunger. Never again will a poor person in this community go without a Thanksgiving dinner. But we do so much more. There's a box going up out here for diapers and necessities. Not for us, but for the community, for anybody that needs it. Our missions, our external missions going out of this church are feeding the poor, helping the helpless. Our external missions need your help. But I'm not here to take your last two pennies. More than that, I don't want your first two pennies. What I want, what we need, is for you to feed your family. Keep your electricity on. Make your house payment. If you need that coffee at 8 o'clock in the morning, by God, get that coffee at 8 o'clock in the morning. That $5,000 figure sounds intimidating. But let me break it down. That's $10. $10 a week from this church. If every adult added $10 a week to their current giving, just $10, we would make our budget and then some. I don't want $5,000 from one person. We've done that. We've had the rich come in and save us. We don't need it. We can support this church as we are. And I don't need a big check to do it. This church doesn't need a big check. It needs pennies. You remember the old commercial for just a dollar a day? Well, we're not feeding one child, we're feeding a community for just a dollar a day. Now, I'd love to say that I have a fantastic ending to this sermon, but that's as far as I got to write before 7:30 in the morning. So I'm going to end it with this prayer. Maybe. May God bless you with anger at injustice, oppression, and exploitation of people, so that you may work for justice, freedom, and peace. May God bless you with tears to shed for those who suffer pain, rejection, hunger, and war, so that you may reach out your hand to comfort them and turn their pain to joy. And may God bless you with foolishness. To believe that you can make a difference in the world so that you can do what others claim cannot be done. To bring justice and kindness to all our children and the poor.